Good morning and welcome to our service this morning. We're so glad you could join us. We'll be starting in just a couple of minutes. And Pastor Sue asked if you'd like to get a candle to join with her in lighting during the service. And we'll start in just a couple of minutes. And remember to type in any joys and concerns you might have into the chat box for us to pray with together.
Up on the news of our congregation is to read the week. like to get on the mailing list, you can email Heidi.
You want the email address?
Yeah.
EWCCSEC.
EWCCSEC.
At Yahoo.
At Yahoo.com. And we have one announcement today. This morning after worship, we'll hold the annual meeting of the congregation on Zoom. If you didn't receive a link, please let us know in the comments below, and we'll be happy to send that to you. Later on in the service, we'll be lifting up prayers. You can share your joys and concerns by typing them into the comments, and someone will be writing them down so we can lift those up together. Also, if you'd like to share your star gift with us, please type your star word into the comments as well. Let us quiet our hearts and prepare for worship by listening to the prayer.
In the season of Epiphany, we celebrate God's light that shines in the darkness. So today, we will light our star candle. To celebrate that no matter where we are and wherever we find ourselves, that God's light is shining there. And so in your homes, wherever you are, if you'd like to light a candle as well, so we have that image of God's light near and far with us. We give thanks that God casts light on our needs and on our hurts, our divisions, and invites us to come and follow and be healed. We give thanks that there are no barriers. All of us are welcome in God's presence. Let us give thanks to the Lord with our whole heart. Let us tell all of God's wonderful deeds. Let us be glad and exalt in God. Let us come together to sing praises to God's name. Let us join our hearts together and worship God. Amen. And let us join together in the hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. We'll sing the first two verses.
From captivity.
Let us come to worship Jesus, our guide.
We come before the one who teaches us how to pray and invites us to spend time with God.
Let us come to worship Jesus, our preacher.
We come before Jesus, who teaches us the good news of God's love and mercy.
And let us pray.
Precious Lord, take our hands. Help us navigate the storms and stress of our lives.
We are often tired or weak or worn.
As you reach out to us, help us to share your love and caring.
Grant us your compassion that we may strengthen one another on the journey.
Welcome us to your table to eat the bread of heaven. Help us be as generous with our welcome, our caring, and our kindness.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
We come together in the light of God's love and we hear the good news that God so loved this world and every single person in it so much that God gave his only Son. In Jesus Christ, we see God face to face and we hear of God's mercy. Standing therefore in Jesus Christ, I celebrate with you the good news that we are loved, we are forgiven, we are cherished by God. Let us rejoice in this today and always. Amen.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
traveled around the Sea of Galilee to preach, teach, and heal people of a variety of illnesses. Through his actions and his words, people began to learn about the power and love of God. Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in their synagogue, who was possessed by an impure spirit, cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," Jesus said sternly. "Come out of him." The impure spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching? And with authority? He even gives orders to impure spirits, and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. May God add the blessing to the reading of these words. Amen.
So here we are in the season of Epiphany. The last time that we were together online for worship was before I got sick, and so it was still Advent and Christmas time. So a lot's happened since then. We were still back then celebrating the birth of Jesus, but all of that is behind us now because the church seasons march on and they don't linger in the birth story. Right now we are in the season of Epiphany, all about the light that is shining that God gives us. Because we have so little information about Jesus as a child or Jesus growing up. The very next thing that we know, Jesus is an adult. He was baptized in the River Jordan by his cousin John the Baptist. He's ready to begin his ministry. And now we are at the very beginning of the gospel story, in the very first chapter of the gospel, according to Mark. And that very first chapter describes what it is that Jesus is going to be doing. It says in very short sentences and very short snippets of stories what it is that Jesus is called to do and what he will spend the next 3 years of his life doing. So really, if you wanted to sum up what it is that Jesus is called to do, if you wanted to say in just a few words what Jesus' ministry was about, you could read these stories. And in fact, I'll encourage you to read that first chapter of Mark sometime. Read tomorrow during a snowstorm. It won't take long, and it will tell you so much about what it is that Jesus has been called to do. So sometimes if you ever wonder if your efforts are enough, the one or two or whatever kind of things that you can do, if that's really going to make a difference, I think we all can appreciate and get some encouragement, because the sum of Jesus' activities is just a few words. So we see that the first thing that Jesus does in Mark is that he calls his disciples. So that's all about invitation, all about welcoming, all about encouraging, looking at some of the most unlikely people and saying, "Yeah, you, I can use you. You can be filled with God's Spirit. You can share your story. You too can be a disciple of Christ." That's something that we can do. When Jesus goes into the temple, he teaches, he tells people about what he knows. And he uses stories that they can understand. He talks about sheep and shepherds. He talks about following. He talks about everyday activities. And he says, that's where God is. God is in our everyday lives, in our struggles and in our joys. And he teaches and he shares the joy that he has, that God gives him. We can do that. And then we have the story that we heard today about Jesus healing people, Jesus taking the broken pieces of people's lives and saying, all is not lost. It looks like nothing can be formed out of this mess, but I am here to tell you that God can give us a new way forward, a new beginning, that God can mend even our broken hearts and we can move forward with God to experience God's love. And then the story after this one is Jesus going to Peter's house and finding that Peter's mother-in-law was very sick, and Jesus heals her, and then the news spreads and crowds start to come. Everyone wants to know about this person sent by God, and Jesus heals many of them. So he was very busy. He was very busy in those few days. But if we will make a mistake if we think that serving God is all about working constantly and getting exhausted and doing as much as we can do and always having a long to-do list, because look at what Jesus does next. After doing all of those things, we're told in the story, Jesus withdraws to a quiet place where he prays, where he's quiet, where he rests, where his soul is restored, where he is renewed. He goes to find peace. Don't overlook this part of the story. It's a vital part of ministry. In fact, ministry is not possible without this peace, without this time away, without this time of renewal. Because Jesus knows that he can't run on empty. He has to have time with God, by himself, to listen for God's voice. Jesus is showing us all about the balance that we all need in our lives. The call to work hard, to do what we can to share the gospel, to live out God's love and to invite people in, and then to take some time to restore our souls. That's why that commandment to take Sabbath is really not an onerous duty. It is a gift given to us by God. God says, come and rest and be renewed. And then because the cycle continues, because we can't live in Sabbath, the next line in the scripture says, the disciples searched for him until they found him and they called him back. So Jesus knew that he would go back to those duties that he had been called to. He would go back to calling and welcoming. He would go back to teaching and preaching. He would heal God's people. And then he would withdraw to a quiet place to rest again. That's the cycle of ministry, and that is true whether you are an individual or whether we are talking about us together as a church. There will be time for activity and busyness, and there will be time for rest and renewal. So we don't have to have this big, long job description. We don't have to have like big, impressive titles in order to be showy about our faithfulness. What we do is offer what we can to God. So whether that's for you knitting a prayer shawl or serving meals at the community kitchen or emailing people that you feel like might be feeling isolated or making a phone call or stopping by and leaving something on someone's doorstep, all of those efforts together, that's what makes us the church. That's what makes us able to continue this ministry of healing, inviting, teaching and preaching. All of this is what we're called to do today. And so today when we hear the story from Mark that Jess just read, we hear about Jesus going into the temple and suddenly being interrupted. So this happens, right? In our ministry, we might have a plan. We might know exactly what it is that we want to do, what we're supposed to do, and then something happens. Something interrupts us. And in this case, it is this man calling out who wants to stop Jesus in his tracks. The description in the scripture tells us that the man was possessed by a demon. In today's language, we would be unlikely to describe someone that way. But we might say about someone, well, that is a troubled soul. Or we might say that this is someone who, by choice or by circumstance, has been damaged by life. It's pretty safe to say that this man was a miserable in his own life, and as a result, he made a lot of other people miserable around him as well. We know people like that. He might have had evil intent. He might have wanted to do harm. He wanted to stop Jesus from doing what Jesus was doing, and he could hardly even help himself. And we know that about people too, sometimes about ourselves. Sometimes we do things that are harmful to ourselves, not even So at that moment, Jesus has two choices. He can either ignore this man, or he can deal with the problem. So instead of just kind of like talking louder and pretending that this guy wasn't here and trying to turn his back on him, Jesus turns to him and addresses him and says, stop. Jesus knows that he can't go forward until he has dealt with this interruption, until he has faced this problem. There is great power in naming the challenge. There is great power in naming the circumstances that are up against us, to name our struggles and to say, I need help with this. This seems insurmountable. This seems like more than I can deal with, more than I can handle. It does make me think about the pandemic, which has brought so many problems and so many challenges in so many ways to our lives. It was just 10 months ago, it seems like forever ago, when we were told that it was no longer safe for us to worship together in our sanctuary, that meeting in an enclosed space was risky because of this airborne disease. And that was a problem. If we had ignored that problem, if we just didn't want to deal with it, if we said, oh, that's too much for us to handle, we might not have had worship at all. There are some surprising number of churches who just have made that choice and aren't meeting or worshiping together. But instead, our congregation named the problem because it is a problem when a congregation can't congregate. It's a problem when we can't be together. It's a problem when we're forced to be separate from each other. But gradually, slowly sometimes, bit by bit, we discovered creative solutions to continue to do what we're called to do. To worship, to serve, to be with God's people, to share God's love. It has been a year of discovering new ways to be the church. During our annual meeting, we will celebrate some of those new ways that we have discovered. But we have discovered that the challenges are real, and yet God's faithfulness is also very real. And God calls us to face those challenges and trust that this creative God that we worship will lead us through. Because we're still called. We're still called to be the people of God. We're still called to welcome people. We're still called to heal, to offer people a place to be in whatever shape they come in, and however broken they might feel, to know that they are welcome here. We are still called to teach and to preach, to feed, It takes courage to name the challenge. Sometimes it's hard to look at a problem face to face. And yet we ask God for wisdom and strength. That is what Jesus did. And that is what we are called to do. So we offer our efforts to God. Trust that day by day that God is with us and that God can work through us. And that no matter what the challenges are, no matter how big those problems might be, that God will give us the strength and the wisdom and the courage that we need to share God's love and God's light near and far. Amen. It's just beautiful. You have a lovely, lovely. Thank you. So I have to say that all the joys are all about music. We've got quite a big fan club out there. People say, yay, music, God bless the bells, beautiful music, love the bells, beautiful arrangements. I'm blessed to have such talented and dedicated musicians. So there you go. Thank you so much. Awesome. Good job.
Thank you, everyone.
Yay. All right, so as we join together in prayer, we want to lift up our concerns and share those with one another. Karen would ask us to pray for her mom, Mary, who is in Pierce Nursing Home after a fall, and also then for Mary's husband, Ed, who's back at home during this time of transition. Pam asked for prayers for her friend, Monique, with bone cancer, and also her friend, Amy, who whose 30-year-old son died from a heart condition. So we want to pray for Amy and her family. And also, Pam mentions that Kenny took a fall, and so he's at Day Kimball, so we want to lift up our prayers for him. Diana asked for prayers for her friend Valerie, whose whole household has the COVID virus. And I know all of you know someone now who has COVID or is recovering from COVID, so lift up those prayers for all of those people. Anne asked for prayers for her daughter Jessie, who's in the hospital with pancreatitis. And Donna asked for her friends Tom and Michael, who are having cancer treatments, and also Tom's wife, who's recovering from a serious medical condition. Also, before worship, Taryn asked me to ask all of us to pray for Robbie, who we've been praying for Robbie for years and years and years. When Robbie was a little boy, he's 13 now. When he was a little boy, he was outside after a storm and a branch fell down and hit him on the head, which caused serious brain damage. And so now for all of these years, Robbie's family have been caring for him, which has been very, of course, very challenging. So he's been cared for by his mom, Angela, and also his grandmother, Judy, and also by his grandfather. And unfortunately, his grandfather just passed away. So this is a huge loss for everyone, so we want to give thanks for his completed life and ask God to give this family the strength and the comfort that they need. And I know that there are other joys and also other concerns that haven't been shared in this public way, but are close in your hearts, and we trust that God hears our prayers and that God is with us wherever we are on the journey. Knowing that, let us join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for this new day, for this promise of light and love during the season of Epiphany, for your promise to journey with us wherever we are. We thank you for your steadfast love and for your faithfulness. We thank you that you hear our prayers. We thank you for the gift of music that lightens our spirits and lifts our souls. We thank you for the many ways that you encourage us to reach out to one another and share words of encouragement and joy, of healing and truth. Help us, even in this time where we are often isolated and separated from one another, help us to share your joy. Help us to share your fellowship. Help us to share your vision that we are together in spirit, that we are the church, your people, and that we are called to share your love and your blessing. We ask you especially to be with those who are in need of your care. We ask you to be with our world all over, with people who are affected and suffering from COVID that has reached every corner of the globe. We ask you to bless those who are working as caregivers, to give them the strength that they need. We thank you for the work of the scientists who have developed the vaccine, and we ask you to help us to share that near and far as soon as possible. We ask you to be with those close to our hearts who need your care, to be with Mary and with Ed, to be with Monique and Amy, to be with Valerie, and ask you to be with Kenny and Jamie, who are in the hospital, and all of those who are being treated. Holy and gracious God, for those who are on the path to recovery, we ask you to give strength and comfort. To those who are mourning the loss of a loved one, we ask you to be with them, to give them the strength.
strength that they need. We thank you that your gift of love is eternal and knows no end. And even when people are taken from us, we know that we share the love that they gave us forever. We pray for our country. We pray for our leaders. We pray for your people across the world. Holy and gracious God, we come before you just as we are and offer to you our prayers. We pray these and all things in the name of our Savior Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Peace of Christ and the strength and comfort of the Holy Spirit.